Hello and welcome back to our course Star and Planet Formation, Lecture 6. Today we're going to talk about giant molecular clouds. We start by talking a little bit about typical molecular cloud masses, how they are measured, and how they are distributed. In the second part, we will introduce a series of initially empirically found scaling relations that determine some of the global properties of giant molecular clouds. And finally, we will talk about typical molecular cloud time scales, such as the freefall time, the crossing time, formation, and lifetimes of giant molecular clouds. Okay, when we study giant molecular clouds, we can do this either in the Milky Way, or we can do it in nearby galaxies that are still close enough for us to spatially resolve giant molecular clouds. The advantage of the Milky Way, of course, is that molecular clouds in the Milky Way are much, much closer to us, so we can use the much higher resolution and study these clouds in much more detail. The problem with clouds in the Milky Way is that the Milky Way, as you know, is a spiral galaxy, and we are basically sitting just within the spiral galaxy here. So that means when we study giant molecular clouds, which are also in the plane of the spiral galaxy, we have to look through the whole galaxy, and so we are limited by attenuation, by gas and dust, when we study these objects, which makes it difficult to get a full census over all the clouds in the Milky Way. So there is a large part of the Milky Way that is just invisible to us, where the data, where this radiation is attenuated. So this is invisible when we are sitting here. Therefore, it's always also advantageous to study giant molecular clouds in galaxies, particularly in galaxies where we have a face-on view. So this is a little bit like looking at the Milky Way from the top. So we can study the distribution and the properties of all the giant molecular clouds of the galaxy and study, for example, is there any changes in properties between clouds that are closer to the center or clouds that are further away from the center. Something that is very difficult in the Milky Way, because when we look in a certain direction, we always have the additional problem to figure out if something that we observe is near or far, which is very difficult for molecular clouds. And this is one of the major uncertainties for Milky Way observations. The disadvantage for extragalactical studies is, of course, the large distance. So even giant molecular clouds are really tiny objects and sometimes also very, very faint objects. So it's very difficult to observe them. And necessarily, we will be limited by our flux sensitivities of the detectors. So we will have only a sample on clouds with a certain minimum brightness. Nevertheless, this is an important tool to get better statistics, and these statistical inferences from nearby galaxies are then usually tested in the Milky Way data. Let's start by looking at molecular cloud masses. First of all, how do we detect cloud masses? A cloud mass itself is not an observable. We only detect intensities. So we need to figure out ways to derive cloud masses from measurements. Most commonly used is the method to derive cloud masses from molecular line emission, for example, from carbon monoxide or from HCN or other molecular tracers. Here we distinguish between optically thin lines and optically thick lines. Optically thin lines, for those measurements, it's usually best to observe molecules or isotopologues that are less abundant. So, for example, when we observe 13CO, that's one of the easiest molecules to observe, we can, in most cases, assume that these lines are optically thin. This is important because when we look at the brightness that molecules emit in local thermal equilibrium, so that's here LTE, local thermal equilibrium, when it has a certain temperature T, then we can write down here the radiative transfer equation. We assume in LTE that our gas emits as a black body, like with a Planck function, with at a given temperature, modified with this term here that describes the internal emission and absorption from radiation in the cloud. Because when we are looking at a molecular cloud and we are looking through this cloud along a line of sight, we are sitting here and observe the radiation. Radiation is coming in our direction. Then along this line of sight, photons can be emitted by molecules, fly in our direction, and depending on the path length, these photons move through the medium, we have a certain probability that along its way it will become reabsorbed, so we can't observe it. The closer it is emitted at the surface, the higher the probability that we actually observe the photon. And this is described by this 1 minus e to the minus tau nu term, assuming that all the properties of the cloud remain constant along the line of sight. When we distinguish between the two limiting cases, that tau is either that much larger than 1, in this case, this factor here is 0, and our radiative transfer solution, the brightness that we measure, is just the Planck function. And in the Rayleigh-Jeans limit, the intensity of a black body is just proportional to its temperature, which is the reason why in radio astronomy intensities are usually given in brightness temperature quantities with a unit of Kelvin. The other limit of a very low tau, so the high tau means this is optically thick, the low tau means this is optically thin, and in this case the e to the minus tau approaches 1 minus tau nu. So these are the first term in the series expansion of the exponential. And we can then write down our relative transfer solution as tau times the Planck function. And tau is here a number smaller than 1. In this case, the intensity is proportional to the tau. Now, the tau itself is the integral of the absorption coefficient kappa dl, where this is here the path through the cloud, and kappa itself can be described as the density times some cross-section per particle. So tau is proportional to the column density of our molecule, for example, the 13CO molecule in a certain quantum state. Which means that when we are looking at a small tau, we are looking at a small column of molecules, and if the tau increases, we are looking at a higher number of molecules. Effectively, in the optically thin limit, we see every photon that's emitted by the molecules along our line of sight, because this E factor here basically vanishes, and we have no reabsorption in the molecular cloud, reabsorption of photons. So we can basically count molecules along the line of sight. And from this number of molecules along in this dimension, we can derive the total mass when we assume a certain geometrical shape. When we look at the optically thick case, so look, for example, 12CO measurements are typically optically thick. And we saw that in this case, our intensity is proportional to the temperature. So by measuring 12CO, we can measure the temperature of a molecular cloud. When we observe 13CO, we measure the optical depth, and we can use then this to determine the masses. This is done the following way. Let's say the total column density of 13CO in LTE is N13CO. When we 13CO is a diatomic molecule with rotational energy levels, and we observe, for example, these photons here. The energy here is something like 5.5 Kelvin about. Now, this column density here is the total column density, and when we want what we actually measure is the number of 13CO molecules that are in the excited state, because these are the only ones that can produce the radiation that we measure. And by using Boltzmann statistics, we can compute the population number as a function, or these are basically column densities in the states 0 and 1, as a function of the total column density and the partition function that determines how at a given temperature the total number of molecules is distributed across the different quantum states. So here C is the partition function. And using the Einstein coefficients B01 and B10, which are the ones for B01, is the probability for a transition from the 0 to 1 state, so that's an absorption, The other one is the opposite case. And these probabilities determine the absorption coefficient, which can be written here like this. And this depends on the difference between the population in the upper and the lower energy state. From this, we can compute the tau by replacing the density with the Coulomb density, so by integrating along the line of sight. So by measuring tau, we can then determine the Coulomb densities. This has many practical problems and uncertainties. First of all, we need to assume a 12 to 13 CO ratio because we are not interested in the mass of the cloud that just consists of the 13 CO molecules. But from the 13 CO, we will compute the number of molecules that are 12 CO molecules, which we can't observe all because they are optically thick. And then finally, from these, we want to figure out what is the total H or molecular hydrogen mass. And for these steps, we need certain assumptions. We need to know how many 12 CO molecules come on one 13 CO molecule. This ratio is typically 66 to 1 in the Milky Way, but can vary. So there's a gradient in the Milky Way from the center to the outskirts. We need to assume a ratio between the CO and the H molecules. So the elemental abundance ratio of H to carbon is something like 1 to maybe, let's say 10 to the minus 4. So one hydrogen, one carbon nucleus for every 10,000 hydrogen nuclei. And this does not yet determine the chemical relationship because we are interested in CO, but typically this is also, most of the carbon is locked in CO, so we are looking at comparable numbers. We then need to assume that 12 CO and 13 CO have the same temperature because from this we determine the temperature. We need the temperature to compute the tau for this. And from this, then we try to figure out the Coulomb density of the hydrogen. So this only works if we have LTE. And we need to overcome the problem that since we have this abundance ratio here, these 13 CO lines are much fainter than the 12 CO lines. So we need to detect them. When we look at optically thick lines, this is usually less of a problem because they are bright, so they are better to study distant objects. However, they are bad for mass determination because when we look at a large cloud, then what we usually observe is only that fraction of the cloud until for any line of sight we reach about a tau of about 1. So we can only look that deep into a cloud because of optical thickness. And all the hatched part here, cross-hatched part, remains undetectable. So this is typically the case when we observe extragalactic objects. And here we have the additional complication that we can't spatially resolve those, and we need to make an assumption on what is the fraction of this undetectable volume and how much does this then correspond to hydrogen atoms. And this is done by the so-called X factor, which scales between the observed integrated intensity of 12CO, for example, and the total column density, which is in hydrogen. And this is a factor as in the order of 2 to 3 times 10 to the 20 per cubic centimeter per Kelvin kilometer per second. So for a measurement of 1 Kelvin kilometer per second, that's a frequency or velocity integrated intensity, we figure out that this corresponds to a total gas column density of about 2 to 3 times 10 to the 20 per cubic centimeter. So this is more of an empirical relation, surprisingly. So the big surprise is this seems to be true for basically everywhere in the Milky Way and also in other galaxies. So we find a more or less universal X factor. There seems to be some physics, some chemistry that produces a constant ratio between the CO intensity that we observe and the total mass that is behind these measurements. And this is surprising, because if a cloud is optically thick, why should the intensity that we measure correspond to the whole cloud mass? It could be that in our comic before, let's say we have here this observable part, it could also be that this looks like this. And then this would correspond to a different X factor. So why could that be? When we look at the mean column density of a cloud, let's say we have a spherical cloud with a certain radius r, then when we observe this, we observe basically the cross section, and that's the area, which is pi r squared. And so the mean column density of this is just the mass of the thing divided by the area, pi r squared, divided by the mean mass per molecule. That's the mean column density. The total integrated intensity is computed like this. And we saw in the previous lecture that under stable conditions, the virial equilibrium, the virial theorem tells us that the kinetic energy of a cloud is about half of the potential energy. We can write down the kinetic and the potential energy as a function of the mass of the cloud, as we saw earlier, and the velocity dispersion, that's the result from the internal energy of the cloud, and the combination also with non-thermal terms. From this, we could write down the virial ratio, and assuming that we have a stable cloud, we saw that this is about 1. So for a stable cloud, or for any cloud, we find this velocity dispersion of the particles. This is important because to compute the integral of the intensity, when we observe the intensity of a certain molecule, what we observe is not a sharp peak that corresponds to the rest of frame velocity of the quantum transition, but this is a smeared out profile, for example due to the Maxwellian velocity distribution of the particle, which in the two-dimensional projection case gives us a Gaussian line profile. So what we find is some Gaussian line profile with the dispersion telling us something about the line width. So we expect that our intensity is a function of the velocity dispersion, because when the dispersion is larger, the integral, the area under the curve, should increase. Let's just, for the sake of simplified arguments, assume that we have a step function so that our profile actually looks like this. So that we don't have zero intensity outside of a certain thing. We can also shrink this, then we come to a delta function. And when we simplify this and look at what is the width in delta nu, in delta velocity, that corresponds to a tau of 1, because the tau is smaller the further away we get from the center. So, and when we say, okay, tau equals 1 is about the place that corresponds to the line width, we can write down the line width just as a function of the center line tau and the velocity dispersion. So tau nu naught is tau at the frequency nu naught. So this is here, this is in frequencies, and we can convert this to velocities just by dividing by this term. So the line width is related to the Doppler dispersion with this prefactor, and therefore the corresponding brightness temperatures are T if we are within this range, and zero if we are without. So we can replace this integral just by 2 times T times the velocity. The factor 2 was because we so far just considered the one-sided case here. So we have, this is sigma. We need to do 2 sigmas then. This can be also written like this. This is proportional to the velocity dispersion. So the intensity that we observe is related to the velocity dispersion. And so we can just, when we just write down, the x factor is basically the ratio between the Coulomb density and the intensity. And we can replace the intensity with what we now saw for the velocity dispersion, and also write in our size and mass and the Coulomb density. So here we can then get this approximation for the x factor, where our density is just the ratio between the volume and the mass and the volume for a spherical cloud. The factor of 10 to the 5 comes because the intensities are usually given in kilometers per second. We are working in a CGS system, so we have to have this factor of 10 to the 5. And if we put in typical numbers, now we get an theoretically approximated x factor just from the assumption that we have a virialized cloud in the order of 5 times 10 to the 19. This is super simplified. And when we look at observations, for example, from gamma ray emission, then we find an x factor of 2 times 10 to the 20, which also compares well to estimates from other detection measures, for example, from dust grains. That's also between 2 and 4 times 10 to the 20. So all these detection here tells us that under Milky Way conditions, we find the same X factor to within a factor of 2. And when we turn this around, it shows that the typical giant molecular clouds probably are not very far from virial balance, because this seems to be the case for most of the clouds. There are a couple of problems. For example, the assumption that CO and H2 are tightly correlated is a somewhat hotly debated topic presently that goes under the label of the CO dark H2 gas, which has to do with the typical chemistry that takes place at the surface of a molecular cloud. So when we have a surface of a molecular cloud, let's say from this on we have H2 gas, then we form CO somewhat deeper. And when we now look through this cloud, then we have in this volume here coexisting CO and H2, but we have a portion of the volume here and here where we have H2 gas but no CO gas. So this is the so-called CO dark H2 gas, and it only is reasonable to assume that in this volume we have a tight relationship between the CO intensity and the H2 gas, and we need to figure out what volume fraction is the H2 that is not related to CO. Okay, let's now look at how the mass that we now can estimate is actually distributed. When we look at the Milky Way and nearby galaxies, then we find that molecular cloud masses are distributed according to a power law with a certain power law index. This is usually truncated for various reasons. The first of all is that any power law, so this gamma is always negative, means we have fewer and fewer instances of more massive objects. And so there is a typical limit at how massive a cloud can become in the Milky Way. For example, it cannot be heavier than the total gas mass that's available in the Milky Way, which is a ridiculous upper limit anyways. But there's also a lower limit. There is a detection lower limit because they become smaller and smaller and undetectable. And there's probably also, and there is the case that the smaller they are, we saw in the virial theorem, then there is no reason to assume that this affects the velocity dispersion in the cloud, but the mass goes down, of course, with the total volume, so with r to the power of 3. Therefore, the smaller a cloud becomes, at some point it will become gravitationally unstable and it will disperse just because the mass becomes too small. So this law is truncated. When we integrate this, we can compute the total mass, which is then related also to the power law index here. This figure shows two observations. So on the left-hand side, we are looking at M33, a nearby galaxy that is almost face on, so that we can detect many giant molecular clouds. And this shows you the clump mass spectrum. So this is the number of objects as a function of the luminosity, not of the mass, but the luminosity, but brighter means more massive. And here the observations are also split into, when we look at the galaxy, into certain annually. So we take all the galaxies that are at least so far away. So this is the blue thing. Then we have the green, which is here. And we have the red, which is the center part. This is to study, of course, the how properties of molecules, molecular clouds change when we move further away from the center. And the dashed lines here are power law fits. And we see that they have approximately similar power law indices. On the right hand side here, we have the measured surface density. So that's the mass in this galaxy. And you see that there is a relative little change as a function of the distance from the galactic center. Typically, when we are looking at the inner parts of galaxies, we find that the power law index is somewhere between -2 and -1.5. And when we look in outer parts of the galaxies, then the power law index is somewhat steeper, which means it is more unlikely to find more massive clouds. So here's an example of the power law of the cloud mass distribution, so the number of clouds as a function of cloud mass here on the power law tail. And you see that, of course, we have here also then a part of the distribution that's not easily explained by the power law. This also shows you the other statistics on quantities, like the velocity dispersion, which seems to be centered around somewhere between 1 and 2 kilometers per second. We have mean density, gas densities of a few hundred particles, and so on. Nevertheless, since we have this steep power law, and most of the gas is found in regions with a pretty steep law, which that means that most of the gas in the galaxy is in large clouds rather than in small clouds, even though the number of clouds is dominated by the small mass clouds. But the majority of the gas, of the mass, is sitting in the few big ones.